I believe we are bringing about the next great revolution in the history of mankind, the transition to the electronic age. Bold words from Gordon Moore, a man not ordinarily known for hyperbole in public, yet he did make that pronouncement, and he did it in public. He didn't do it last year, or in 2000, or 1990, or 1980, but he did it at an industry conference in 1975. That was 40 years ago this year. And as we think about that, we might spend about a nanosecond asking ourselves whether it seems that Gordon was correct in his assumption. But we now know that he was correct because he's good at predicting things. And Moore's Law, which is his namesake and is one of the greatest technical and business predictions of all time. And now Moore's Law is the main title of a brilliant new biography of the man who has enabled so much of the history that we celebrate at the museum. The subtitle of the book is just as important. The Life of Gordon Moore, Silicon Valley's Quiet Revolutionary. Quiet Revolutionary is a bit of a paradox, and if it suggests to you that this is a book that is rich in the complexity and the brilliance and the humility that is Gordon Moore, then you would be right. I can't say enough about this book. It's just an absolutely fantastic work, and I am delighted to be welcoming Arnold Thackray and David Brock to the museum today. Arnold Thackray is the founder and now chancellor of the Chemical Heritage Foundation in Philadelphia. He served as its chief executive for 25 years. He is the founding chairman of the Department of History and Sociology of Science at the University of Pennsylvania, a distinguished historian, and is currently the Joseph Priestley Professor Emeritus. There are a handful of institutions that Gordon Moore held close to his heart: Caltech, Intel, the Moore Foundation, and the Chemical Heritage Foundation is absolutely at the center of that cluster. Arnold's close and longtime relationship to Gordon is evident throughout the book. David Brock is senior research fellow at the Institute for Research at CHF. He is a prolific writer and scholar, and among his many distinguished works is a fabulous documentary history of Fairchild Semiconductor, which he wrote along with Christophe Lecuyer in 2010. And as I mentioned, he's also the author of the cover story in Core magazine. Please join me in welcoming Arnold Thackray and David Brock. Good morning.
Good morning.
David, welcome.
Well, after you, Arnold.
Welcome to you both.
It's very good to be here, and thank you for the invitation. And this is one of our favorite places because John has done a brilliant job in making computer history come alive. So thank you, we're here.
It's a team effort. Well, that's very kind, and you're very kind, so thank you very much. Let's talk about this because we have so much to talk about, and it just is a romp through a remarkable life. I want to talk for just a minute about the process of writing the book. Can you just take us through the number of hours, the number of oral histories you did with Gordon in particular, the way that you went about doing this?
It did take a long, long time, and if you look at serious biographies, that's often the case. It depended on the transistor to record oral histories, but also to communicate among the authors, that basically there was an author here, an author in Massachusetts, and an author in London. So we required modern communication. It took essentially about a decade and began simply with doing oral histories of this man who obviously in our book was the most important chemist of the era. And that's how it started. Is that right, David?
Absolutely. And you know, one of the real, I guess, treasures for me in the whole process of working on the book was the number of extraordinary people we both got to spend time interviewing. Gordon Moore himself, we spent, I don't know, how many hours would you say, Arnold? Dozens of hours with him in interviews. His members of his family, especially his wife, Betty, but also many of his colleagues from, going back to Shockley Semiconductor through Fairchild and Intel. So just a remarkable group of people to be able to speak with.
You know, the opening of the book is almost biblical in that you go back through the lineage of the Moore family, but you do that for a very important reason, and we have a photograph actually that if you have ever wondered whether Gordon Moore is a child of California, this picture should answer all of that question.
And John, you go to a very important point there, and it's the paradoxical point about the innovator. Gordon Moore's a fifth generation Californian, backwoodsman, as you see. Pescadero, to get there and back, took you 3 days in the 19th century. His great-great-grandfather was the founder, the first guy to see Pescadero Valley and say, this will work, and make it into farming land, its rich bottom land. The family hunted, shooted, fished. Gordon Moore's father, who had to leave school and support his family when his own father died, he left school at the age of 15 or so, he used to take lumber, redwood trees, from over there to over here, to Palo Alto, horse and cart. Took 3 days to go to and fro. I mean, this was a different world, but it's a world in which the Moore family is settled, 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 and Betty's family is equally settled in Los Gatos, just down the road, in the Valley of Heart's Delight. Again, a very different place. So these two people are local yokels. I mean, that is what they are. And that's crucial because when Gordon had the marvelous opportunity to come back to this area, he knew where he was, he knew what he was, he knew who he was, and he very quickly figured out what he wanted to do and then just did it. End of story. But contrast that with everybody else you know in Silicon Valley. They weren't born here. When they get here, they're fundamentally saying, who am I, where am I, what am I trying to do, et cetera, et cetera. So Moore's law comes out of a very different way of thinking about the world. And that's, I think, crucial to understanding everything about Gordon.
I'd just add maybe one or two things, just for your benefit. The figure on this photograph, who's second from your left, the kind of tallest figure in the photograph, is Gordon's paternal grandfather. And this picture is the Moore boys before a hunting party. Just thought that might be of interest. And
Gordon, of course, continued to go back to Pescadero to go hunting with the family into his 60s. You know, that was recreation to get back into this world.
Yeah, and I guess the last kind of point I would make is that with the exception of just a number of years you could count on your fingers, Gordon Moore's story really took place within a 50-mile radius of Pescadero. His personal life and his professional life. So it's, I've quipped to other people that he changed the world by staying at home.
That's a great line. That's Walter Henry Moore, as David said, second from the left. Now, one important point we're making early is that he's grounded here, he's settled here. And the second is that his interest in chemistry started at a very young age. He was experimenting with all kinds of things as a young boy, including explosives, a big experimentation with explosives. And we have another picture if you want to show. This is...
Here is the book.
This is the well-worn book of
and
explosives.
It's a serious book. It's it's by the director of research at the Alfred Nobel Company, who knows about nitroglycerin and nitroglycerin explosives. And Gordon bought it at Bell's bookstore they wanted $7 for it. It was an important book, but then it was marked down to $4. Gordon The most important event in Gordon's life, in a certain way, was that his father, with no education, became a part-time constable riding a horse out in the hills, a full-time constable, and then was asked to move to headquarters in Redwood City. And when Gordon was 10, they moved to Redwood City, and they encountered California's new, burgeoning, excellent educational system. And suddenly he was going to a serious school, and his next door neighbor, the same age, a little boy, got a chemistry set for Christmas. And Gordon helped him start using it. And Gordon got serious. Gordon's recreation when he was in his teens was to make explosives, explode them in his backyard. He lived on Alameda de la Pulgas, which was very rural. Then give nitroglycerin to his friends so that they could explode it. Okay. So he was into the science and very quickly well ahead of the school curriculum.
Yeah, there was just a very strong manufacturing streak in his engagement with chemistry from the very beginning. And on a number of occasions, his father's chosen profession shielded him sometimes from the consequences of that manufacturing. There was a time they used the explosives as a rocket propellant. One of the rockets one time found its way to a roof. It was good to have a dad in the sheriff's department, so.
He makes his way to San Jose State College, as it was known at that time. We have a picture of Gordon about that time. And he meets a woman who's, of course, very key and influential in his life, Betty Whitaker. Talk about what it was like for him. He only stayed at San Jose State for 2 years, and you have quite a bit in there about his experience in college.
Well, you have to remember the context. This is immediately after World War II. The GIs are coming back. The universities are crowded. By the end of high school, he's already cottoned on it. He's going to be a chemist. He wants to go to college. First in his family ever to go to college. He thinks about Berkeley and decides it's easier in Redwood City to get on the train down to San Jose each day and go to San Jose State. So he starts out there, and within a couple of years, he's decided, gee, I really should be at Berkeley. And so he transfers. By then, he's met, as John said, Betty Whitaker, this charming young lady, and the two of them are beginning to go steady in the fashion of the 1950s. And Betty, who's actually a year ahead of him, graduates. Enormous difficulty getting a job as a woman. She started in sociology, got pushed out by the GIs, went into journalism, and eventually landed a sort of back office job in downtown San Francisco, lived with her uncle in Berkeley. Betty came from an educated family. Her uncle had a PhD and was a serious sociologist and is the person who gave Betty the idea of being serious. So Betty kind of knows the score, and Gordon's just in love with learning. I mean, that's really what it is.
Yeah, I would just maybe underline that Gordon really had the luck of the age he was when he was pursuing his undergraduate studies, because this is, of course, if not the golden age, then the upswing toward the golden age of the California's investment in public education, which he truly made the most of. First is, as we were saying, a commuter to San Jose State, where he was, as many people today do, you know, you knock out all your requirements at either a local school or community college and then transfer to a different institution. And in Gordon's case, that was Berkeley. And for the time that he went, there was no tuition at Berkeley whatsoever. I think there was a $100 student fee, which was annual. So it really was a tremendous opportunity for him.
He graduates from Berkeley, he goes directly to Caltech, and has a couple of pretty amazing experiences at Caltech. First of all, he becomes a teaching assistant to Linus Pauling, the Nobel laureate. He's also exposed to Richard Feynman. He's not only a dedicated student, but a really amazing student. He finishes his PhD in less than 3 years.
And he's publishes a couple of things out of it. No, he just loves being down in the basement lab. It's in the sub-basement. He's doing infrared. You don't want things to be interfered with. He's always on the borderline between physics and chemistry. At one moment, he wondered whether he wanted to become a mathematician, but then decided that making things explode was more interesting than what a mathematician would ever do. So he stayed with chemistry, but he's always on that border. And Berkeley, Caltech are just rife with people winning Nobel Prizes at that time. The chemistry departments of both institutions are enormously strong in strong institutions. And he is basically acing the curriculum, making no waves. You basically don't see him. He's down in the sub-basement, and Betty in the evening, in semi-despair, has probably gone to join him down there and kind of read a book down there, because at least she can see her husband. But he's through there in record time.
Yeah, it was also one moment where, in a way, electronics and semiconductor materials enter into his professional life. Part of what he was doing, I think it was the basement of the Crelin Laboratory where Badger had his lab. As many experimentalists will do, a lot of the work is tweaking and transforming the instruments in the laboratory, and Gordon worked on enhancing one of the instruments in the laboratory with a semiconductor detector that allowed them to get these very fine measurements of the behavior of molecules. So that was really, in a way, when electronics and chemistry were really starting to come together in his experience, I would say.
There's also another motif that it isn't very fashionable to think about today, and it's that military funding is of the essence of everything. The Cold War is on with a vengeance, and the military is funding scientific research, so it's the Office of Naval Research that's funding the lab in which Gordon works. And in due course, when he's looking for employment, government employers, military employers, are one of the great places of employment, and that motif is going to be there in the background from the very start of his career through into early Intel days. It's really, you know, what was essential to making this happen, and the answer was a precarious defense situation. I mean, the threat, we forget it, but the threat of nuclear war was real. And the answer of what you do in that context, one of the things you don't do is have weapons dependent on vacuum tubes, which is what you've actually got. So replacing the vacuum tube in due course becomes a huge military priority. But we're leaping ahead there, John.
In fact, he heads to the military when the newly minted Dr. Gordon Moore graduates from Berkeley, goes to APL in Maryland. They weren't very happy moving to the East Coast, were they? I take from the book that Californians through and through living in Maryland wasn't the greatest experience for Gordon and Betty.
No, but it was in the early 1950s, with a PhD in chemistry, it was very difficult to find employment in California. He actually thought, what he sort of thought, like many another PhD, was, oh, I'll become a professor. And he actually would have made you could just see him there as a professor of physical chemistry, this sort of quiet, smiling figure. The only problem was the job market was a bust. There'd been this enormous surge of GIs hiring to accommodate them. That was over. The baby boom was way in the future. There was a severe shortage of students, so you didn't hire more faculty. So he gave up on that idea. And then, well, what do? And the default is a government lab just outside, government-funded lab just outside Washington, D.C., where they're actually doing serious research. That's the they had a basic research component, and that was the lure that there was a group who he could respect. And he was already on that level where, you know, don't waste my time with anything, but where is the research frontier? But it was a very different research frontier, but it was the frontier. And they encountered things like, you know, segregation in public facilities. And to the man from Pescadero, that was a foreign land. The weather was the weather of a foreign land. Everything was foreign. And they had their first child. Ken was born there. And all the families back here. And Gordon, showing his propensity to calculate, sat and reflected and calculated the cost to the government of his work divided by the numbers of readers of each publication and decided, this is unsustainable long term. I need to get out. And that's when he started looking at California options. And he actually interviewed at Lawrence Livermore, was offered a job at Lawrence Livermore, decided, no, this isn't quite what I want. And it was because Shockley had the defense clearance to be able to read things from Lawrence Livermore that he looked at the resumes of people who didn't go to Lawrence Livermore and saw this guy who was good enough that they wanted to hire him, but he turned it down and he's still out there somewhere. I must call him up. And so Shockley, with, you know, why is Silicon Valley where it is? It's all Shockley's mother. It's Shockley's mother, that is the answer. That Shockley, 100% funded by Arnold Beckman, said, do you mind awfully if I do this little startup close to my mother? I have to be close to my mother. His mother's in Palo Alto. Shockley Semiconductor is just over the line to Mountain View. You call up Gordon Moore. There wasn't another PhD chemist in the world at that moment who knew where Mountain View was. But Gordon knew it was just 20 miles from his family and in the other direction, 20 miles from Betty's family. And they wanted a research chemist. I mean, it's a no-brainer.
In fact, that's the opening line of the book. It's the famous, the phone rings in the Moore household, he picks it up, and or perhaps it was at his desk. He picks it up and hears, this is Shockley. Here is the advertisement that Bill Shockley was running in a lot of places, looking for people to work on semiconductor research and development. And of course, he's in this famous building.
Which, incidentally, this is really, really sad. This is the historic start of Silicon Valley. This building on San Antonio Road between Embarcadero and 101. And if you go there, it is a heap of concrete on the ground. It was demolished in the past week. And that, alas, shows the, you know, the easy attitude toward history, towards the past. Throw it away. It doesn't matter. Folks, it does matter. If there's ever going to be public understanding of what this venture is all about, what the Computer History Museum is about, we've got to teach history, and you teach it in part through artifacts. And there's the prime artifact just shredded. So I hope someone in this audience will say, gee, we really need to get even more serious about what we do about the past. And the footnote says, it's a great industry. Britain today has three things that kind of bring it money and fame and glory. One is science, and per capita, they have more native-born Nobel laureates than the United States does. British basic science is very fine. The second is finance, and you all know how that story goes. And the third is tourism based on history. And every time you shred these places, you're shredding economic opportunity. So stop it.
Very good. That is probably the best commercial for preservation I think anyone could ever have given, Arnold. So thank you. David, Shockley is a pretty remarkable judge of talent, and he assembles an amazing team. How could he have done that at this point?
It's very hard to say. You know, he had a tremendous track record with that in the groups that he had assembled at Bell Labs and their phenomenal successes there, and really repeated it. At Bell Labs, before he left to join Arnold Beckman and create this laboratory that was aimed at kind of the most, initially aimed at the most, producing the most advanced form of silicon transistor that had just kind of been cobbled together at Bell Labs. You know, Shockley had done all sorts of analyses at Bell Labs about sort of creative productivity. Who were the people at the labs? And he found that a tremendous amount of the patents and advances were due to a small number of people. And he even advanced a kind of heuristic theory, an idea of mental temperature. So you needed people who had this high mental temperature for them to be extraordinarily productive. And evidently, that's what he went out searching for. And it's a little bit hard to, you know, dismiss whatever he was using as a guide, because he surely collected an extraordinary group of people in the laboratory.
The place where the guide failed, not only for Shockley, but for Dow Chemical, where Gordon interviewed, is Shockley, an earlier Dow Chemical, sent him to psychologists for psychological testing. It was one of the things in the 50s that you really liked to do with candidates. And in both cases, the answer came back saying, this individual has no management capabilities whatsoever. So that killed Dow. Shockley loved it because Shockley wanted to be the manager and he wanted people who weren't. It's the footnote to that is you'll find a Fortune article in which Gordon is interviewed in, I think it's 2008, and he says there, I was the longest serving and most successful CEO of Intel, period. So I guess he did have some management ability.
What is he doing for Bill Shockley in that, as it turns out, rather brief time that he was there?
Well, just quickly to try and address it, this very advanced form of silicon transistor that had been developed at Bell Labs, the crux of that was a kind of a chemical process called diffusion, a way to basically chemically treat silicon to give it particular electrical properties, if you will. That's a crude shorthand, but this kind of central chemical process to making this new kind of transistor. And that's really why Shockley needed a chemist, and that's the getting the laboratory's arms around diffusion so they could actually make silicon devices was what Gordon really jumped into. Diffusions take place at a high temperature. You need a furnace, and you need a very particular kind of furnace for doing it. You know, very fine temperature control, nice even temperatures across the furnace. And that's what Gordon set out to build for the laboratory almost immediately after arriving. There was no place that they could go to buy this kind of silicon electronics manufacturing equipment. That industry didn't really exist at all yet.
So there's a duality there, because Gordon, two things. He was abandoning all the chemistry he'd done, that he started knowing nothing about the chemistry that's Shockley and then Fairchild and Intel would be all about, but he was coming home. He was coming home, and that outweighed all the rest. So in he walks and starts doing what obviously had to be done. I mean, go back to that building on San Antonio Road. It's pretty rudimentary, and everything you're going to do, you've got to put together and figure out how to do it. And this practical guy from Pescadero, no, just love that. Here I am, close to home, putting stuff together and seeing if I can make it bang, metaphorically. I mean, you know, this is easy.
Yeah. The story of how Shockley's incredibly talented staff hit the rocks with Shockley as a terrible manager, I think, is well known. But one of the things that I think people may be so surprised about, especially given Gordon's reticence to to be the manager, to be the guy in front, and really to engage in sort of direct confrontation or conflict, a characteristic that shows up again and again, is that when it comes time to bell the cat and go to Arnold Beckman and say there's a problem, the group selects Gordon to be their representative.
Well, it defaults to Gordon. They're meeting, you can picture it, you know, you go and have a coffee together, you go meet together, say the boss is a bust, what on earth are we doing here, what do we do? And eventually you get around to, we better call, telephone Arnold Beckman, and you all sort of look around and, oh, someone should telephone Arnold Beckman. And Gordon's the guy with the, you know, the logic, the analytic, and can just see, yeah, someone has to do it. So it's not a natural at all, but if someone has to do it, so if you're all just standing there, okay, give me the phone. And he calls Beckman. And of course, in the end, that seals their death warrant, because in a complicated dance, Beckman, complicated among other things by Shockley just getting the Nobel Prize at that moment, Beckman says, gee, I can't walk away from my Nobel laureate star researcher, so you guys all get in line. And they know that that's sort of death. But their idea of what to do with themselves is very modest one way round. But since they actually all enjoy trying to make this transistor and make it work, they sort of say, gee, we've actually spent a lot of time on that. We'd love to finish up. Maybe some company would buy us all and kind of just own us all, and we'll do it and give them the transistor. And that's their starting thought. I mean, there's none of this kind of venture capital stuff or anything of that kind. It's a desperation move. And the fact that the one of them, Eugene Kleiner, has a father who knows something about finance, so they ask Gene Kleiner's father what to do, and he knows this bank in New York that's kind of interested in new ventures and transistors, and Arthur Rock becomes the guy on the case, and a different enterprise entirely from what the eight of them imagined is born.
Yeah, I would just like to add that, you know, in addition to Gordon's self-assuredness or sort of sense of himself from his kind of very centered and rooted life to that point, I think was part of what was in the mix for him saying, I'll call Beckman. Beckman was himself another Caltech chemist, so maybe he thought they would have some sort of natural rapport in that sense. But another factor that I think was at play in the discussions about this dissident group from Shockley's laboratory in thinking about, they could all have just gone their separate ways and very easily gotten jobs wherever. They were among the few people who had experience with transistor electronics. And in the U.S. electronics industry in general, but in the transistor business in particular, there was tremendous, what we call in the book, negative unemployment. There was a huge demand for people, no matter if even they had the most tangential experience with transistors. So they were sure that they could go their separate ways. And against that backdrop, they thought, well, but we really like working together. We think we've got this transistor within our sights. Let's try and leave together.
And they do. We have a photograph, the very famous photograph of the traitorous eight. That's Gordon on the far left, Bob Noyce in the middle. This was not the day they started the company, by the way. This was a little later in the process. Actually, it's always struck me how marketing-oriented the group was, or maybe even had a sense that they were doing something in history, because this photo shoot, and there are many photographs that came out of them individually in this photo shoot, really was a pretty remarkable thing that was even thought of and done at all.
Yeah, well, that's Noyce, I think, and the Noyce A was always oriented to the public. That's what he was. But B, he was the guy who actually knew about transistors, germanium transistors, not silicon transistors. But he And he was employed, he was hired from Philco, the Philadelphia company, because transistors belonged on the East Coast. So Noyce was the one guy in the group who really was familiar with the industry and could just see, yeah, of course this stuff has potential, of course this is where it's going to go. And he was the natural person to be the PR man, the public face. And Gordon, it's characteristic, he's off on the edge of the photograph. He's not, you know, he's not looking for recognition. He's the guy who calls Beckman because it's sort of defaulting. He doesn't stand up and say, I'll call Beckman. It's only because they're all sitting there kind of looking round and round that he says, oh, gee, I'll call Beckman. I mean, and that's the sort of Gordon that, do I have to? Do I have to? Do I have to step in the limelight? I don't think so.
It's critically important that he's there at this point as the director of research and development. Talk just a bit about his role relative to the development of the planar process, the planar integrated circuit, and the chemistry that he was working on at that time.
Well, when they the group started Fairchild Semiconductor, they kept their focus on creating the what was called variously many things, but among them the double diffused silicon transistor. And so they really kept to their plan, and they felt that, and they were correct, that they were very much in a race toward this device. Knowledge of the diffuse silicon transistor was, knowledge of it was widely spread. Bell Labs was even promoting this technology. So they were in a race to the market with it. And it was, again, making the final transformations of these techniques and accomplishments that had been achieved in the laboratory and crafting them into a real manufacturing technology, what we call in the book a chemical printing technology. And at Fairchild, for instance, Bob Noyce and Jay Last really worked on bringing what's today called photolithography into the mix for fashioning these transistors. Gordon himself became focused on an area that was and is called metallization, how to form these metal contacts on the transistor, to print these contacts, if you will, and really made a very important contribution that swept the industry using aluminum only for making these contacts. It sounds like a may sound like a minor piece of trivia, but it was very important for manufacturing. And Gordon was there working at the bench to figure out kind of the recipe to make that work. He helped develop the transistor that turned out to be Fairchild Semiconductor's first product. He moved with it from concentration on things like diffusion and metallization to really move into engineering and kind of shepherding this transistor into manufacturing. And once it was in kind of production and there were various other rearrangements going on, that's when he became kind of the head of R&D for the firm. Mm.
He also, and you reveal this, I think, very skillfully in the book, he is an advocate for two really important business decisions that happen, not just simply technical decisions. He writes a very famous memo in January 1959 where he, as you say, he landed on a philosophy of standard types rather than special purpose devices, a really important decision and a contribution he makes. And there's a direct quote in this memo: there is no value in developing something that cannot be built in volume. Now, that's not a novel idea, but yet it is important that he becomes an advocate for this.
Yeah. Now, he's one of the things in the background of Gordon is this endless, quiet, rational calculation. It's displayed very vividly when he and Betty get married. From day one, he keeps the financial book. And there it is. Everything is written down. The price of a cinema ticket, what we went to see, what it cost. Everything is calculated out. That's a piece of who he is. So that he gets to the idea, gee, we need volume. Production isn't surprising there. What's interesting, I think, in that early period is, A, it's a little bit like biotech. You know, we're all here, we're all highly skilled technical people, we're going to create a product, but it doesn't exist. It takes them a year to get to their first thing on the market, and this is after Shockley, this is a year at Fairchild. Someone's got to be putting in money and faith. That's the one side of it. Another piece of it is, by the standards of the day, this is very small scale, high purity chemistry. From today's aspect, it's laughable because we've gone down millions and billions in the order of magnitude. But by the time they were doing it, it's very meticulous, very exact. It fits in with this guy who sees things sharply. You know, he comes to a black and white, he's all shades of gray, but he comes to a black or white conclusion about what should be done. And volume is a piece of that. I mean, it's, you know, let's not discuss, we need volume. And that, of course, is one great key to what Fairchild and Intel will do.
Yeah, I guess you could think of it as you know, really trying to, if he is focused and really deep within this chemical printing technology for making silicon electronics, this philosophy of standard types or philosophy of standard products really is deeply related to making the most out of that chemical printing process. If you think about printing, if you have an intuition about typeset printing, metal type, somebody having to, a typesetter having to set up all the type to print a single page. Well, if each page is customized, if each page is different, that's a lot of work of design for the typesetter to do each page differently. If you can find a page that everybody wants, you can set the type once and just keep printing it, and you get really a great advantage of the printing process there. And that is a looking for these essentially universal parts to make as microchips that any user of digital electronics, including computer makers, would want. That was the thing that really Gordon and his colleagues were searching for at Fairchild, and then very much so at Intel.
There's another pivotal moment here that you use as another recurring theme in the book, which is that the company is so successful that the parent company had reserved the right a year after the start to step in and purchase the entire company, which it does, in October 1959. And Gordon Moore and the other founders receive, as the result of that buyout, what in today's terms would be a $3 million payout. Each of them makes that much money a year after starting the company. And you take that occasion to say that it never caused him to waver at all in his pursuit of his career, his vision, the professional work that he was doing. What do you think is behind all that?
Yeah. Well, Gordon, in a way, is the biggest and best example of a classic reality of scientific, technical innovators and builders. The reason they get into it, the reason that they do it, the reason that they love it, has nothing at all to do with making money. They didn't sit down one morning and say, I sincerely want to be rich. How do I do it? That's when you go to Goldman Sachs, with the results we all know. But they say, I love this science and this technique. And then, in due course, they say, oh, gee, I'm rich. This is a real kind of issue, problem, challenge. And of course, what is so wonderful and what our American society is deeply kind of entwined with is they say, how can I give this money away in ways that will do good? And Gordon is a supreme example of that, because at one stage he was the richest man in California. But he's in this very, very tiny group of people who have given away more than half of what they possess in their lifetime. If you can't take it with you, it eventually becomes relatively simple to give it away. But in your lifetime, you can take it with you. And there's very few people who have said, no, I must give it away and I must get really into that now. So it's a very deep-rooted and wonderful, wonderful, wonderful trait there.
As Fairchild is booming from 1962 to 1965, he's documenting his own vision for the future of the electronic age. The paper that we're celebrating is published in 1965, and that's the one that sets forth the theory we now all know as Moore's Law. But in 1962, he writes a 100-page essay as a chapter in a book on microelectronics. And you say in the book that this essay was the seminal intellectual breakthrough of his life. Can you talk more about that, why you phrase it that way, and what exactly he was saying?
The thesis that we're trying to support there is that, here's Gordon Moore, director of R&D at Fairchild. He's really in the heart of this, the advance of this chemical printing technology and what it can do. And one of the things it can do is to print circuits in really almost just the same fashion that it used to print the individual components for them. So instead of printing a whole bunch of transistors on a wafer, cutting it apart, packaging up all those little silicon die, making individual transistors, selling it to people who then wire it together into a circuit, they've come up with a way to, let's just print all the transistors onto the wafer, print the other needed components, print the kind of wires to connect them, and cut it apart as complete circuits. And he is, and within his laboratory, a team realizes a vision that Bob Noyce originally had about this planar integrated circuit, drawing on this planar process, an innovation by Jean Ernie, another co-founder of Fairchild. And so Gordon has kind of the best position to understand what's happening with planar integrated circuits, which are, you know, roughly speaking, the kind of microchips that the world has enjoyed since. He's got a great vantage point for understanding that, understanding the chemical printing technology, so he's following what's going on. The microchip, the silicon microchip, is an example of a kind of a broader class of efforts into microcircuitry that stretched across the 1950s. This effort to make circuits smaller, more reliable, less power hungry, better. And in that discussion and in that effort, it had always been the case where people were saying basically that, well, maybe microcircuitry could, you know, in high volumes be cost competitive with conventional circuits, but, you know, pretty much they'll always be more expensive. They may lower costs overall, et cetera, but microcircuitry is going to be more expensive. One of the first realizations Gordon had was that maybe that equation didn't hold for silicon microchips, that that this would in fact be a route to better electronics that were also profoundly cheaper. And so he had been watching these developments, watching the early years of the microchip business and technology. And in this chapter that you mentioned, John, he kind of lays out in a wonderful way the details of the chemical printing technology and then works out this economic argument. He has formulae about different costs and how they interrelate, and he basically comes to a conclusion that right now, some of their microchips are cheaper than the conventional circuitry, and he lays out an argument that this trend will continue. If the chemical printing technology, if they invest in it, it seemed very open-ended to extension, that it would allow for smaller transistors, more complex microcircuits, and those would represent both better and profoundly cheaper electronics, particularly digital electronics. And in the close of that chapter, he draws out some conclusions from it, that computing systems of what to that point would have been unimaginable capabilities would become possible, that the type of computing systems that were then available would be dramatically lower in price, and indeed that silicon electronics would pervade society, including consumer electronics. So that's a pretty bold conclusion.
In 1962.
Yeah, the chapter appeared in 1963, I think.
Yes.
And but you know, that was he had developed kind of the argument, seen its conclusion, and saw where it could lead.
Should we be shocked, Arnold, that he felt so strongly about documenting all of these thoughts? I mean, a lot of people who are as busy and successful as this would never take the time to sit down and put all of this down on paper.
Well, Gordon, a piece of Gordon is being this reflective person who wanted time alone. If you grow up in Pescadero and in the woods, you spend a lot of time alone, and he really wanted and needed time alone, and time alone when he was doing the job. He always had time alone in which he would think and write. There's an amazing number of memos by Gordon. One of the challenges of contemporary history is, you know, where is the stuff? Where is the documentation? And we eventually discovered in neglected space at Intel, there were file cabinets and file cabinets stacked with memos and thoughts by Gordon. So we could very easily begin to get into the background of things. All that material is now, I'm happy to say, in the Stanford archives with a copy at the Chemical Heritage Foundation. But it's, this was a man of reflection and a man who knew in the end always what was the decisive action, and in the end would either take it or nudge someone else into taking it. And that was the preferred mode, to indirectly and obliquely nudge someone else into taking it, especially if it was a controversial action. Why don't you do that?
The paper published in 1965 had two curves in it, and we have a picture of the two curves, which essentially are the very famous realization of the theory you were talking about, David. And I had to just juxtapose these two graphs with the next one you're going to see. This was Gordon's chart of his own income.
Yeah, this is the first exponential, and it, you know, it starts on the day of his first job, back in the East. And as you can see, you know, the curve actually rises pretty sharply.
Gordon was always thinking about exponentials. Yeah.
Yes.
So you can see from 1955, it increases pretty steadily, and then in 1961 it goes vertical, which is a great. But on a more serious note, you wrote in the book, Arnold, that this paper setting forth Moore's law changed him in a profound way, and the understanding he achieved in the spring of 1965 guided him the rest of his career. What was it about this paper that changed him in such a fundamental way?
Well, I think it's the combination of several different things. One is he's mastered the technology. You know, he's made this radical shift into a different sort of technology. He's mastered it. He can see its potential. He's seeing the markets, and he's doing this mathematical type thinking about the future and seeing, fellas, all we need to do is to keep going, to keep going. Now, there's 1,000 practical problems every day, but what we need to do is to keep going. And of course, the fact that Fairchild gets into difficulties shortly thereafter, and you know, that Fairchild consists of a big East Coast company and a curious group of people doing something else again in California. And when Noyce is passed over for CEO of Intel, I'm sorry, of Fairchild, because he's too young. By East Coast standards, he's far too young. And he decides he's going to leave. Gordon decides, okay, I'm leaving with you. And Intel comes in just at the right moment because they can design a new company. And Moore's Law, as we now call it, that's what we're going to do. We're going to pursue this thing, as it were, from here to eternity. And that, of course, is precisely what Intel has done from 1968 to today, and always being on the front end. And it's this insight, and if you will, it goes back in the end to Pescadero, because all we need to do is to be consistent, to know who we are and what we're doing. And if you think of the fate of corporations, it's the moment when a corporation ceases to know what it's doing that all the trouble starts. And Gordon is the right man in the right place at the right time, because he loves pushing the envelope, thinking about it, pushing the envelope, and nudging other people into doing what they should do. And this is the story. Now, it would be a trivial story, except this is the technology that has changed the world. This is the one essential ingredient, the ability to do this. And he's the guy who theoretically sees it. And Moore's Law is a wonderful thing, because, of course, it's not a law of nature. It's like the speed limit law, except unlike the speed limit law, I, Gordon Moore, am going to see that this law is enforced. And hundreds and thousands of people will, and millions and billions of dollars over time will all be assembled to make sure that this law is followed. And again, it's back to that consistency of the man that, you know, if you look from the right vantage point, it's all obvious. Once you see it, it's obvious, and all you have to do is do it. And why don't you sort out the problems?
We have a picture of the very famous newspaper article that was published announcing that Noyce and Moore and others were leaving Fairchild to form their own electronics firm, and also a picture of the first offices of Intel on Middlefield Road. Ironically, the building designed by Jean Ernie for Union Carbide after Ernie left Fairchild to try to go do his own thing. It's back to the lab bench now, as you say in the book, for Gordon, although the industry is moving so fast, their theories are proven. What was it like for him to play that role at that point in his career, to, you know, literally be going back to the lab bench and working?
In many ways, it was the mirror, or not even the mirror image, it was very similar to the opening experience at Fairchild Semiconductor. In essence, in designing what Intel would be, Gordon Moore in particular, but also Andy Grove and Bob Noyce had a deep insight into what seemed to be the most promising areas of development within this chemical printing technology. So they kind of were able to say, let's start off on the right track. They had kind of like two variations of the advanced chemical printing that they were going to use as the basis of Intel. Two possibilities or two variations on kind of the best silicon printing press that they could build, and then aim toward what looked to be a very attractive, essentially universal part, microchip memory. Memory in computers was where the majority of cost of a computer resided. It was dominated at this time by a different technology called magnetic cores. Gordon Moore in particular believed that with this new advanced form of chemical printing, they could create memory microchips that would first be competitive with and then completely outperform cores. So they were aiming to take over this. Microchips had already taken over kind of the logic of computers. Now they were aiming to take away memory from cores. And so it was in establishing this new version of the chemical printing technology, Gordon was right in there solving some really fundamental problems and overcoming some fundamental hurdles to getting this chemical printing process going, so-called silicon gate MOS technology. He came up with a process for they called it annealing, which was prevented kind of breaks of the interconnecting wires on the chips that Intel kept as a very closely guarded trade secret for some time before getting a patent on it. So he was involved in a couple different breakthroughs that got silicon gate MOS technology kind of churning as their manufacturing approach.
The other thing that's fascinating that shows the enormous change in a decade is when the traitorous eight wanted to leave Shockley, they wrote 33 letters to companies saying, have we got a deal for you? And 33 companies said, I don't think so. And it was only then through back channel connects that they found their way to Sherman Fairchild, who said, okay, let's do it. When Intel was started, Arthur Rock raised significantly more money inside 48 hours because it was clear that transistors were an expanding, profitable market. And Intel very rapidly, if you do the curve of Intel profits and so on, it's really exponential.
It was all the capital they needed, and in fact, all the capital they raised until they went public in 1971. Which leads me to something else, that another decision that he made, Arnold, that I'd like for you to talk about in particular, given what you said earlier about Gordon as a manager. They make an early compensation decision that turns out to be pivotal. There had been an imbalance in compensation at Fairchild, which you write about and which bothered Gordon. And he decides to take this on first thing when he comes to Intel, in part by issuing stock options to every employee or having every employee be eligible. Talk a little bit about that, if you would, and the impact of it.
Yes. Well, again, we're making this very rapid cultural transition from a world of large corporations, of bureaucracies, of salary structures, into a world in which venture capital becomes a recognized term. Startup and breakaway become recognized terms. That period from the mid-50s through to 1970 is the period when all of that happens in the sense of becoming a known, observable, different way of thinking about and organizing in the world. Fairchild has all these other spin-outs, breakaways, taking place. I mean, Moore and Noyce are loyal to Fairchild, as it were, and you can see what's beginning to happen. And part of the discontent is that Eastern headquarters are, oh, everybody's on a salary, and you know, stock options. Why would we do that? What is that? You're all on a salary, and you know, maybe your salary will go up according to some scale or other, but that's, you know, that's how life is. So there was the negative learning experience of, gee, this doesn't work. This isn't fair in some sense. And then the positive, the pescadero man, if you will, the common man, says everybody should be able to share in what is happening. And if we succeed, everybody should be able to share in it. Now that had two attributes to it. One is it made, in the fullness of time, a lot of people rich, but it also meant, gee, I'll stay at Intel, and I will be part of this enterprise of making it all happen. That there's a reason to stay with the company, and that was that was crucial, and I think was again embedded in Gordon's reflections on what is happening, what am I seeing, what would be the regularities here, what do we think about those regularities, and it becomes a no-brainer that this is what they're going to do. This is how Intel is going to be.
There's one final question I want to ask you about Intel. We've got a photograph here, a very famous photograph of Gordon and Bob Noyce together with Andy Grove there on the left, and the rubylith print there on the table. You quote, this is much further along in Intel's transformation, you quote Les Vidéz, who's here today, saying he led the transformation of Intel from memory and logic to a computer company of a different color. And I wonder if he gets enough credit for those various inflection points that Intel went through, or as he, in the public mind, almost become so identified with Moore's Law, the much larger principle, that the work he did as CEO and chairman at Intel for a long time perhaps isn't quite as noticed.
I think that's exactly right, and that's why Gordon is saying in the Fortune magazine article, I was the longest serving and most successful CEO of Intel.
He's taking ownership.
Did you hear that? You know, did you hear that? That's the kind of the one aspect of what is going on there. But the other aspect is this nudging. I don't want to be in the limelight. I don't want to be in the limelight. Somebody else should be in the limelight. And there's this marvelous photograph I think Intel was the company of the year, David, was that right? And there's this photograph, and there's Noyce, and there's Andy Grove, and sort of edging out of the edge of the photograph so that you can't really sort of see him is Gordon Moore, because he preferred to operate by nudging other people, that was his sort of his preferred mode.
Let's take a couple of questions from the audience. How influential was Betty in Gordon's career, and what sense do you have of their partnership regarding his work?
Well, if I may, and then David may want to add to this, I think absolutely crucial. The two people crucial in the story of Gordon Moore. One is Betty, and the other is Andy Grove. Mm-hmm. And Gordon really operates best by seeing the big picture, thinking about the big picture, thinking about the technical issues. If you can get to the lab bench on your own and mess about on your own, that's sort of heaven. But you don't want to be the person standing there sort of managing in the obvious sense. And the personal life of the family was managed by Betty. If you meet Gordon and Betty and you sit and talk with them, before you long you realize that it's Betty who's holding the conversation, and Gordon's kind of there smiling or not smiling. Andy Grove is absolutely the same motif at Intel. And Andy Grove said in an oral history interview we have, I loved it because it so expresses it. If I succeeded better at Intel than any other employee, says Andy, who was the first hire, it was because I was better than anyone else at reading Gordon Moore's facial expressions. Okay? That's the secret. And then, of course, going out and acting on what he'd see. I mean, that's the other half to how it works.
Here's another question about something you said earlier about Silicon Valley's roots. Some people would say Silicon Valley started with Terman's lab at Stanford and Hewlett and Packard and others in the 1930s and 40s, and not with Bill Shockley. What say you?
Well, two things. One is success has 1,000 fathers, and we're talking about success. So if we can't identify 1,000 fathers, it's not a success. So that's take one. The second is it called Terman Valley? What is it called? Is it called Stanford Valley? What is it called?
Yeah. David, if you could touch on this one just for a moment. Aside from the military applications that we've talked about for rockets and other things, what general purpose applications did Gordon foresee, perhaps foresee first? You touched on a couple at the end of that famous essay. And how did he identify those?
You mean like when he was articulating Moore's law initially? Yeah, well.
In those initial years, I think, is the sense of the question.
Right. I think that once, so Gordon kind of had worked out in this long chapter, this kind of proof of these fundamentals, if you will, this philosophy of standard products and the economics of integration, and really convinced himself very rigorously about where this would head. That was in a chapter in a technical monograph, surely not a very wide printing, pretty constrained. When he wrote this article that appeared on April 19th, 1965, it was for Electronics Magazine, a weekly, very widely distributed, who can know how widely read it was, but he's reaching a much bigger audience, and there he is, the shift seems to be he's much more declarative. You know, he's not a person to, he's very analytical, very careful, so for him to draw this curve of we're going from 60 components per chip to 60,000 in a decade, this is kind of planting a stake in the ground, if you will, and some of the, so part of his article is addressing the question, you know, what would anybody do with a chip with 65,000 transistors on it? And some of the answers he gives are things that really resonate. He talks about home computers. What they were, who knows? But, you know, he could see this movement into the home, to the consumer electronics space. He talked about an electronic wristwatch with increasing number of functions. That's very a la mode today. and then some less, maybe less directly consumer things like advanced radar systems and, of course, advanced computing systems.
Arnold, you have been involved in the history of science for so long. I think this question is perfect for you. Law is a significant word in science. Was it a misnomer to have called this Moore's law instead of Moore's principle or Moore's something else?
I think if you're being scientifically correct, the answer is yes, that is a misnomer. But if you've ever met a policeman, he thinks he's enforcing the law, and that is a set of social regulations, like you shouldn't be traveling down 101 at the speed you're traveling down 101. And in that sense, Moore's law is absolutely a social law that, we will double and redouble the number of transistors. And of course, the ultimately interesting thing about that is we are coming to the end of Moore's law, and it really kind of characterizes most of the lifetime of most of us in the room. If you think back in history, it's like the people who lived in the first railway age and the railroad mania, the ability to not have to get on a horse, but to get on an iron horse that took you to visit your friends in faraway cities effortlessly. That transformed life. Moore's law has and is and will for another decade or so continue to transform the life of the world. So it's a social law, and all the more remarkable that this very scientific man should promulgate a social law and make it be observed. That's what we're celebrating.
There's one final question here, which actually goes along with the final photograph that we have for you, which is Gordon, the philanthropist, at an event at which that philanthropy is being celebrated. How happy, this is the word used in the question, how happy has Gordon or have Gordon and Betty been in this phase of their lives as one of the leading philanthropic families in the world?
I think that they are happy that they believed and decided to do this, and indeed it goes right back in their lives. It goes back in Betty's case to very systematic church membership and giving that went with that. Betty's family actually experienced great wealth to disastrous ends. That Betty's father, Betty's grandparents owned half of Oakland, and Betty's father inherited a huge amount of money as a young man and totally misspent it and destroyed the family and everything. And Betty's mother essentially ended up a single mother. This is at a time it's all scandal, divorce. Betty grew up with a divorced mother and a grandmother is the crucial thing. So Betty had seen wealth misapplied. She really knew what that was. And Gordon and Betty, I think, did a remarkable job, still do a remarkable job. They live in the most straightforward manner you can imagine. Watch Gordon do the washing up. So that's the one thing. The other thing is, I think that they discovered, as every family launching some great philanthropy has discovered, that, gee, this is not as easy as it looks to get it right, and that the world's approach to great philanthropy is no good deed will go unpunished. Stand up for punishment. So there's that aspect that sort of goes with it. And you can sit in your armchair and say, oh, gee, would it have been better just to live a quiet life? But I think it's what they really have wanted to do. And Gordon is still the chairman of the board of the Gordon and Betty Moore Foundation. And that symbolizes the commitment. But philanthropy, like many another good thing in life, is difficult.
Go ahead, David.
Just to add one thought to it, I think that if you look at Gordon's professional career, he was very animated and passionate about a challenge that he thought was significant and had real meaning. And I feel that he is engaged in a similar sort of challenge with his philanthropy at the Gordon and Betty Moore Foundation, in which really exploring the ways in which you can take what you might describe as a kind of a Silicon Valley high-tech approach to business, very analytical, very data-driven, a lot of measurement, and the challenge is to see how those tools and techniques might be brought over into philanthropy. It's proven to be a true challenge, but I think there is that same sense of engagement with a problem that he thinks is worth grappling with. That's my personal impression.
I think it's still true that there are only two family-controlled foundations in the world which have more than $1 billion in assets and where the founders are still living. One is the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation, and the other is the Gordon and Betty Moore Foundation. Hmm. Just a couple of closing thoughts. It's time for lunch. All of you are invited to lunch. Lunch is being made possible through the courtesy of and the generosity of the Chemical Heritage Foundation and Intel and Kenmore. So we'll be going across to the Grand Hall to have lunch. There is a book signing, so we're going to let Arnold and David sign books for about 30 minutes. Then they've got to eat too, so we're going to have them come to lunch. And we're screening this wonderful film as well, which I think you're going to really enjoy. I want to reassure all of you who asked questions about the future of Moore's Law, and there are quite a few up here, that is the subject of the afternoon session. So I didn't ask any of those, so you have to come back at 2 o'clock. and see the really wonderful session that David Brock is going to be moderating with Carver Mead and Bill Davidow. And finally, I want to say that the free distribution of CORE magazine today is being underwritten by Jack and Casey Karsten, who very generously have allowed us to increase the circulation of the magazine 10x this year, beyond any year that we've ever been able to circulate it. They're here today. And if you see them, I hope you'll thank them. And Jack and Casey, that's for you. Finally, I asked David at dinner last night how many silicon transistors are in the world today. And David, being the crack researcher that he is, did a little research overnight, and he's going to tell us the answer to that question right now, or his best estimate, I'll
put
it that way.
My best guess about silicon transistors humming away now could be as many as a sextillion, if you assume that perhaps the last 5 years of production are still humming away and in use, roughly. Sextillion is a large number. If I'm not mistaken, it's a billion trillions. So to give some sense of that, that kind of annual production of this scale is something like 14 billion transistors a year for every living human. Just a tremendous number. If you go on the web and search, as I have, for what is a reasonable estimate of the number of grains of sand in all of the beaches of all of the world, some of the lower estimates are at this level of 10 to the 21. So if we're not there, we're close
we're
to
approaching it.
So it's a very large number of transistors, to say the least.
Arnold and David, it's such an amazing book. I feel like we've only been able to scratch the surface this morning. I urge you to read it. If you think you know a lot about Silicon Valley, prepare to be surprised. And if you think you know a lot about Gordon Moore, be prepared to be educated and very surprised. It's such a wonderful book. Congratulations, and we'll see you at lunch.
Thank you, John.
Thank you very much.